Going to go over the same example that we went over last time with using XML to exchange data between the server and the client, at least with the one request. Remember, in the dictionary example, we actually have two Ajax requests made to the server. We have the first request where we take the string of data that's been typed into the text box and get a list of words back. The second one is when you've actually selected an English word and you want a Spanish translation. That second one we're not touching at all. That's simple. That is only returning one value. We really don't have any need to do anything different with that. All right? And I think that's an important point, because as I go over these other ways of doing things, keep in mind that it's not like there's a right answer or that one's the best way to do it and the others are lesser ways of doing it. If that were the case, there was one way that was the best way to do it and the other ways were just sort of inferior versions of that, then we wouldn't even bother talking about the other ways. Each of these ways has distinct benefits to it, and on one end of the spectrum is the limited data. At the other end of the spectrum is XML. And sort of in the middle is JSON data. JSON sort of takes the best of both worlds in a way. All right. So what we're talking about is, instead of passing the limited data back from the server to the client, we're going to pass XML data. What I like to do, first of all, is define what I mean by XML data, and then talk about when it's a better choice than the limited data. Talk about the relative advantages and disadvantages of XML data. First of all, what is XML? What does XML mean? What does it stand for? Yes?
Extensible Markup Language.
So we've seen the phrase markup language before, where we've seen it in HTML. The ML in HTML stands for markup language. And what we talk about when we talk about something being a markup language is that it uses tags to designate meaning. So for example, in a regular HTML page, if we have a heading on our page, you know, my web page, and we include it in an H1 tag. By putting it in a tag, we give extra meaning. In other words, that's not just simply the words, my web page. It's meant to be a heading, and therefore the browser knows what to do with it. Likewise, if I say link to page 2, and I include that in an A tag, we've tagged it so that that is not simply text link to page 2. It's actually a link to page 2, so when we click on it, we go to it. So we give extra meaning to stuff on our web pages. It's not just a blob of undifferentiated text. We give special meaning to text and content and other stuff on our web pages by including that in tags. All right? And we know what tags look like. They typically come in pairs. And there's a starting one and an ending one. And we know everything between it then has some sort of special meaning. So that's what we mean by markup language. It means we're going to use tags to designate meaning. All right? Extensible means that it's not simply a rigid set of tags. It's tags that you can extend and you can make your own data. All right? And you can make your own formats for data. Let's put it that way. And as long as both parties agree, and when I say both parties, I mean the person that is sending or the entity that is sending the data and the entity that's receiving the data, as long as both parties agree upon and understand the format, then they can communicate that way.
With HTML, you have the W3C that defines the format of these are what the tags mean in HTML. And then browser makers make their browsers to work using those tags. So that's both parties in that case. All right? And there's a set of predefined tags, right? You can't add an HTML tag. I can't say, like, VH1. I didn't do that on purpose. But VH1's a very important header tag. VIH1, how about that? It's a very important header tag. No, you can't do that. You can't just make up your own tags, right? With extensible markup language, though, you can. You can make up your own tags, and you can make up your own set of tags to use for whatever purpose that you want to. As long as whoever's making the tags and whoever's using the tags understand and use the same format. Well, in this case, in the case of an Ajax example, all right, we are making up the tags to create them through our server-side code, and then we are consuming those tags by writing the client-side code that processes it. So, if we follow the rules of XML, all right, one thing that we get is we get, and one thing that's built into browsers, are objects that allow us to parse XML fairly easily. I say fairly easily because you still have to do some work. It's not simply a piece of cake, right? You still have to do some work to parse it. But we have objects that help us to do that. All right? So as long as the data that we create follows the rules of XML, then we have some code that can help us do our job. What do I mean by parse again? By parse, I mean break apart a blob of data, all right, into its pieces. So let's think back to the quiz. Let's think back to the quiz example. In the quiz example, we had the limited data where we returned back Y's and N's. They got first question right, second question wrong, third question wrong, fourth question right. We get that back as just one big string. All right? We have to, quote, parse it. That is, we have to break it down into the individual answers. That, yes, the first one they got right, the second one they got wrong, and so on. So we can do that pretty easily by simply splitting the data into an array using the split command in JavaScript. And we use a delimiter to split it, and we break it down that way. In the dictionary example, our job was a little harder, but the same basic idea applied. We got back a word, an index, then a colon, another word, and another index, a colon, another word, another index, and so on down the line. And we had to do a little more work there. We had to split it twice. We split using the colon to break it down into the individual pieces, and then we split each piece using the semicolon to get each field of data. The terms I used last time were record and field. We split, first of all, to get the individual records, then we split to get the individual fields. So that's what we do with delimited data. All right. What are the limitations of delimited data? In other words, why do we even use something other than delimited data for this? Delimited data is very good if you are returning back homogeneous data. All right. What do I mean by that? I mean data where every row looks the same. Every row looks the same in our dictionary example. All right? We have a word, a semicolon, a number, a colon. Then we repeat that for as many words as we have. All right? So every piece of data looks the same. But let's imagine a more difficult search. All right? Let's imagine where we were doing a search where we were returning information about books in a library, where we could search maybe by subject, we could search by author, we could search by title, we could search by all different kinds of things. All right? If I were to type in a author, if I type in an author name, let's say, I type in Smith, right? There might be a bunch of Smiths in the library database. So I might display a list of names of the authors Smith, right? For each author, there might be a list of books that they've written, all right? I might have more additional copies of the books. For example, I might have a hardcover and a paperback version of a book, all right? I might have video recordings that they did. So if I typed in Charles Dickens, I might have, let's imagine what I might have. I might have a hardcover copy of Tale of Two Cities, a paperback copy of Tale of Two Cities, a graphic novel version of Tale of Two Cities. I might have a video recording of Great Expectations, a biography of Charles Dickens, and so on. In other words, I might get back a lot of different kinds of information if I did a simple search on an author. I might get biographical information. I might get information about books. I might get information about editions of books. I might get information about video recordings or books on tape by that author. So I could get back a lot of different kinds of information. That is very difficult to represent using delimited data. Because what you have to do when you have delimited data is you have to give a record type associated with each record. So maybe if I did a search on Dickens, and again, we're just thinking of the famous Dickens, right? Charles Dickens. There could be like Bill Dickens, who was also a poet, all right, in Illinois, or something like that, that might have some books. So, if I did a search on Dickens, I might get back something like this. If I was using delimited data. Let's do this. Oh, we could do this a bunch of different ways. I'll do it the way I probably would do it in this hypothetical case. Maybe he was born in 1801. Back might look like this. And this is what I mean by heterogeneous data. In other words, the data is different. Each row is not the same. The first row in this hypothetical example example, is author information. The second row is information about hardcover books. And again, there might be a whole bunch of twos, right? There wouldn't just be the one, but I got lazy. But there might be 15 twos of all the hardcover books by Charles Dickens in the library. Three indicates paperback, so there might be a half dozen paperback books. Four might be video recordings, and again, I have a couple of video recordings. And then we start with the next author whose name matched. In other words, we start with the next person named Dickens. And there might be a whole bunch of Dickens that were authors. Now, what's tough about this with delimited data? What's tough about this is our code has to recognize that these rows all go together. And our code has to figure out that it has to know that one means author information, two means hardcover, three means paperback, and so on. So our algorithm has to keep these things grouped together to understand that a Christmas story, the author associated with it is Charles Dickens. All right? And our code has to do that. And we don't really have any help doing that. We have to manage the matching up of all those data. And then when we get to this person, we know, okay, we've now started a different person. All right? So any books that are after this person belong to that person, and so on. What does this number represent? It represents, like, we might assign an author a number, and that's how we group all their pieces of work together. The idea, though, is that we have to manage that ourselves with our code, all right? Now, in the case of XML, we use tags, and the tags help us manage that grouping and matching up this heterogeneous data together. So, what would the XML for this look like? The XML might look like this. I might have a search tag indicating that this is search results. I might have an author tag with a name, with a first name tag, Charles, and a last name, Dickens. Then I might have hardcover books, notice about this, right? It's taken me a long time to write this down compared to how long it took me to write that down. That's actually relevant. Charles Dickens. All right.
notice again, we're returning back different pieces of data like we're returning here, but we indicate what those pieces of data are via tags. This makes our job parsing the data very easy. In other words, if I simply wanted to display the different authors, my code would have to be smart enough to know that one means author, so skip any rows that aren't one. All right? Whereas in XML data, I could simply say, give me all the author tags. For each author tag, give me the first name tag and the last name tag. All right? How do I know what hardcover books belong to Charles Dickens? Well, I find the tag associated with Charles Dickens, and I grab all the hardcover tags that are associated with that tag. And the good news is there's objects that help us to do that. So we don't have to write code that looks at each character and looks for greater than signs and slashes and all that. All right? We can simply say, give me every author tag. For the first author tag, give me the first name. Give me the second name. Give me all the hardcover books associated. Give me all the hardcover tags associated with that author. For each hardcover tag, give me the title. All right? And so on. We can write fairly simple, straightforward commands that do that. All right? And that do that for all the data in the XML data. So we don't have to write the logic that's smart enough to match up these things together, because the tags already tell us that. And just like HTML tags can have the values of the tags, that can have attributes, we can have attributes on our XML tags if we want. So for example, if there was an author ID, we could put that as an attribute of the author tag if we needed that for whatever reason. So the difference between these two, if I could summarize, is this is unstructured data. This, we get back a blob of data, and our program has to sort it out and understand what goes with what. This is structured data. It comes back as a series of tags, and it's built into the data what belongs with what. And there's objects that allow us to pull out the stuff that belongs together. We just have to know how to use those objects and make the call to that. So if I was going to summarize when to use XML versus delimited data, all right, XML is most useful when the data is more complicated. When you're not returning back homogeneous data, but heterogeneous data. That is data where each piece of data means something a little bit different. In this case, we have data about people, hardcover books, paperback books, and video recordings. All right? That's better represented with XML data. Now, with every advantage comes a disadvantage. What do you suppose the disadvantage of XML is? And I'll give you a hint. It has to do with the fact that it took me a lot longer to write that than to write that. All right, let's talk about the concept of overhead with data. All right, what do you think I mean with overhead when I talk about overhead? Yes?
Like extra computing or resources that are needed.
Yeah, and extra computing resources. And specifically in this case, I'm talking about the extra data that we have to make this work. So, what is our, quote, overhead with delimited data? Well, if we follow the same strategy, like if we used commas and semicolons to separate this data, what's the extra data This, I suppose, counts as extra data. This is a number, so maybe that counts as extra data or not. All right, I'll say this is, this isn't. But the commas are extra data. That's not really data.
That's what we're using to separate the pieces of data. So the comma isn't something that we're going to output to the user. The comma is something that we need to get our job done.
So the commas are overhead. The record type is overhead. So if we were going to look at this, we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27. We would have 27 bytes of data. And how many bytes of overhead? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 bytes of overhead. So out of 34 bytes total, 7 of it is overhead. That would be roughly 20%.
All right. And actually, with the delimited data, that number probably would be smaller. All right. For real delimited data. This example, the overhead seems a little high. Let's count up how much overhead we have for the author in XML.
And let's just do the same amount, the author's name.
Overhead we have though.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41.
I'm not going to count them all, but we're already, I'm not even all the way through, and we have 41 bytes of overhead.
All right. So, to extrapolate a little bit, it probably would not be ridiculous to say that when I was finished counting, we would have, say, 70 bytes of data. I just made up that number, but the convenient thing is that does, that makes my math easy, because that almost adds up to 100 bytes of data.
Let's say we had 73 bytes of data. That will really make my math easy for me. All right. That means for 100 bytes that we're sending, only 27 of them are real data. So therefore, overhead. All right. So we're sending a lot of extra data to get that extra benefit, which, I mean, logically makes sense, right? We're sending better data. We're sending more complete, more structured data over. Of course it makes sense that we're going to have to send more characters over to accomplish that, right? We're sending more stuff over. We're sending more data over because we're sending information about the relationships between data. So, we're going to send more characters over. So that can be a problem. We actually did some studies for a project I worked on ages ago. And it is actually that delimited data took up about 1/10 the data in our particular situation as compared to XML. So what does that mean? Well, that means that you're sending 10 times the data for every time you're sending some data between the client and the server. Now, does that prove to be problematic? Well, it depends on the problem, and it depends on the data. So if you're sending back simple data,
homogeneous data, then the limited data is probably the way to go. If you're sending back complicated data, where there are a lot of different data types and there's relationships between the pieces of data, then the benefit that you gain by sending that is probably better to send that rather than sending the limited data. So it's a trade-off. Overhead versus more complete data. All right.
Get element by tag name.
and you can pull the value of a tag out of that. Now, these only work if you give legal XML. And what is legal XML? Well, the rules are similar to the rules of legal HTML, but they're a little stricter. So, for example, in HTML, it's possible to have some tags that don't have an ending tag. In XML, every tag has an ending tag. All right. XML, all the tag names are lowercase, I believe, as are attribute names. There's a few other restrictions, but pretty much it's the same. The main difference is that every tag is going to have an ending tag. All right, so let's look at our XML example. And we'll talk about what's going to be the difference and what's going to be different, what's going to be the same between the delimited example that we saw last week and the XML example that we see this week. The one thing that we haven't talked about today, and we'll talk about it in a subsequent class, is JSON data. JSON is a different way of representing data, and you can almost think of it as being between delimited data and XML. You know, if I was trying to think of an analogy, but I don't know. None of the analogies rolling around in my head are good. But if delimited data is a screwdriver, and XML might be the Swiss Army knife, all right? It has a screwdriver, but it has 50 other things in there as well. JSON data might be a screwdriver that you can swap the tip on, so you can get a Phillips screwdriver or a regular screwdriver, maybe a big Phillips screwdriver, a little Phillips screwdriver, and a big and little regular screwdriver. I guess what I'm saying is that delimited data is less versatile, more simple. XML is the most versatile and the most complex. And that's not a coincidence, by the way. The versatility comes at a price. All right, and that price is complexity. And then finally, JSON fits somewhere in between. Not as simple as delimited. Not as versatile as XML. On the other hand, it's more versatile than delimited, and it's less overhead than XML. So it fits in that niche, sort of right smack dab in the middle. All right, so let's pull down the example that we had. And let's look at what we had last week. And then we will look at the XML version of it. Before we do that, though, I want to sort of play a thought experiment. Let's look at the delimited version. And let's see if we can predict what code is going to change and what code is going to stay the same. Again, we're comparing the delimited version with the XML version. Now, I've already said that the second Ajax request stays the same. So this guy, dictionary 2, is going to stay exactly the same. And everything in my dictionary HTML that relates to that second request, get translation and display translation, that's going to stay the same. I already know that. Of course, you can't see any of this. But the only thing that we're going to talk about here is the first request.
that second request, everything about the second request is going to stay the same. All right? And why is it staying the same? Because this is even simpler than delimited data. We're simply getting one value back. That is the translated word. So we're not even getting back enough to justify delimited data. Remember, the whole reason for even having this discussion is because we want our server to return back multiple stuff. All right? And when the server returns back multiple stuff, there needs to be a way for the client to differentiate and to parse and to break down that multiple stuff into its components. So again, the second request where we're simply returning the Spanish term, there's no need to even parse that. And likewise, over here, where we make the request and display the translation, nothing's going to be changed there because, again, we're simply getting back one value from our server-side code. No need to break it down. Is this code going to stay the same or different between our XML and delimited version? That's going to stay the same. Why is that? What does this code do?
That's just setting up the request object.
That's just setting up the request object. So we're going to make the request the same way. We're using the same object to make the request to the server. All right? So that's not going to change. Is making the request going to change? We have a vote for yes. Any other votes? Actually, this isn't going to change, right? We're making a request the same way. We're going to ask the server to give us a list of words that start with A or AB or ABC or whatever, right? That's the same whether we're getting it back as delimited data or whether we're getting it back as XML data. So the request is the same. All right. The server-side code that produces the output, is that going to be the same? Well, no, all right, because it's going to be outputting XML. It's not going to be outputting delimited data. So you can see in this case, we're delimiting, we're outputting stuff separated by semicolons, and then stuff separated by semicolons and colons. We're not outputting any XML tags at all. All right, so yeah, that's going to have to change. And finally, the code that parses the results and, in this case, produces a dropdown, is that going to change? Yes, it's going to change because it's now getting the data back as XML and not delimited data. All right, so it's going to have to parse XML as opposed to parsing delimited data. So really, two pieces of this are going to change to convert this. We make the request in the same way. We create the request object the same way. What changes is the PHP code is going to respond with a different kind of data, and then the client-side code is going to have to deal with that different format of data. So that's the two pieces of this that are going to change. Now, I will say, if I was doing this example for real, I would not use XML. But I wanted to show you the same example done in all three formats. XML really works best when you have different data and not just a homogeneous or homogeneous block of data. All right. I'm going to copy over the XML version. just to verify to you that it works the same way. So now if I go to my web browser and type in localhost, dictionary.html, from the user's perspective, it should be no different. All right. What I want to end today with is showing you what I'm getting back from the server. I'm getting back XML. My root node, that's one thing I didn't mention, but every XML document has a single root node, like one tag that everything is contained in. It's called the root node. In HTML, that would be the HTML tag. In this case, I have the word list tag. And my word list consists of a series of items. Each item has a word and an index associated with it. Now again, without going and counting the number of characters, you can see that this is a much more data we're getting back, because again, the overhead is much bigger with XML via delimited data. So that's what we get back. All right? I'm going to spend a second looking at the server-side code, and then we'll pick up on that next time. We'll notice a couple things right off the bat. First of all, we output the data differently. I put content, I create a header that says I am outputting XML. Now, what is the importance of that? The importance of that is now the data is going to go back to the client in a different way. It is not going to go back into the variable called response text. It is going to go back to the variable response XML. So that's one difference that you'll notice when we continue looking at this on Wednesday, is that the data does not go back to response text. The data goes back to response XML. Now, the rest of the logic is very similar. The only difference being is, instead of separating things by commas and semicolons, we wrap things up in HTML tag, not HTML, but XML tags, and output that back to the user via an echo. Just like we did before, except we're outputting a bunch of tags. The shell of this looks the same, but instead of outputting semicolons and colons as a separator, we output the tags as a separator. Okay. Next time we'll take a look at this again to make sure that we understand how the XML is being created, and then we will look at the code that parses the XML. All right? And again, we're not left on our own for that. One of the benefits of using XML is you get an object that helps you to parse XML. XML is a standard format for data exchange. Therefore, someone has already written and incorporated into the DOM the logic to handle XML data in an XML object.
So we will go and see how we can use that to parse it. All right, that's all I had for today. Any questions? All right, we'll see you over in lab. I'm going to go over the same example that we went over last time with using XML to exchange data between the server and the client, at least with the one request. Remember, in the dictionary example, we actually have two Ajax requests made to the server. We have the first request where we take the string of data that's been typed into the text box and get a list of words back. The second one is when you've actually selected an English word and you want a Spanish translation. That second one we're not touching at all. That's simple. That is only returning one value. We really don't have any need to do anything different with that. All right? And I think that's an important point, because as I go over these other ways of doing things, keep in mind that it's not like there's a right answer or that one's the best way to do it and the others are lesser ways of doing it. If that were the case, there was one way that was the best way to do it and the other ways were just sort of inferior versions of that, then we wouldn't even bother talking about the other ways. Each of these ways has distinct benefits to it, and on one end of the spectrum is the limited data, at the other end of the spectrum is XML, and sort of in the middle is JSON data. JSON sort of takes the best of both worlds in a way. Alright. So what we're talking about is, instead of passing the limited data back from the server to the client, we're going to pass XML data. What I like to do, first of all, is define what I mean by XML data, and then talk about when it's a better choice than the limited data. Talk about the relative advantages and disadvantages of XML data. First of all, what is XML? What does XML mean? What does it stand for? Yes?
Extensible markup language.
So we've seen the phrase markup language before, where
we've seen it in HTML. The ML in HTML stands for markup language. And what we talk about when we talk about something being a markup language is that it uses tags to designate meaning. So for example, in a regular HTML page, if we have a heading on our page, you know, my web page, and we include it in an H1 tag. By putting it in a tag, we give extra meaning. In other words, that's not just simply the words, my web page. It's meant to be a heading, and therefore the browser knows what to do with it. Likewise, if I say link to page 2, and I include that in an A tag, we've tagged it so that that is not simply text link to page 2. Is actually a link to page 2. So when we click on it, we go to it. So we give extra meaning to stuff on our web pages. It's not just a blob of undifferentiated text. We give special meaning to text and content and other stuff on our web pages by including that in tags. Alright? And we know what tags look like. They typically come in pairs. Then there's a starting one and an ending one. And we know everything between it then has some sort of special meaning. So that's what we mean by markup language. It means we're going to use tags to designate meaning. Alright? Extensible means that it's not simply a rigid set of tags. It's tags that you can extend and you can make your own data. Alright? And you can make your own formats for data. Let's put it that way. And as long as both parties agree, and when I say both parties, I mean the person that is sending or the entity that is sending the data and the entity that's receiving the data. As long as both parties agree upon and understand the format, then they can communicate that way. With HTML, you have the W3C that defines the format of these are what the tags mean in HTML. And then browser makers make their browsers to work using those tags. So that's both parties in that case. All right? And there's a set of predefined tags, right? You can't add an HTML tag. I can't say, like, VH1's a very important header tag. VIH1, how about that? It's a very important header tag. No, you can't do that. You can't just make up your own tags, right? With extensible markup language, though, you can. You can make up your own tags, and you can make up your own set of tags to use for whatever purpose that you want to, as long as whoever's making the tags and whoever's using the tags understand and use the same format. Well, in this case, in the case of an Ajax example, all right, we are making up the tags to create them through our server-side code, and then we are consuming those tags by writing the client-side code that processes it. So, if we follow the rules of XML, all right, one thing that we get is we get, and one thing that's built into browsers, are objects that allow us to parse XML fairly easily. I say fairly easily because you still have to do some work. It's not simply a piece of cake, right? You still have to do some work to parse it. But we have objects that help us to do that. All right? So as long as the data that we create follows the rules of XML, then we have some code that can help us do our job. What do I mean by parse again? By parse, I mean break apart a blob of data, all right, into its pieces. So let's think back to the quiz. Let's think back to the quiz example. In the quiz example, we had the limited data where we returned back y's and n's. They got first question right, second question wrong, third question wrong, fourth question right. We get that back as just one big string. All right? We have to, quote, parse it. That is, we have to break it down into the individual answers. That, yes, the first one they got right, the second one they got wrong, and so on. So we can do that pretty easily by simply splitting the data into an array using the split command in JavaScript. And we use a delimiter to split it, and we break it down that way. In the dictionary example, our job was a little harder, but the same basic idea applied. We got back a word than we split to get the individual fields. So that's what we do with delimited data. All right. What are the limitations of delimited data? In other words, why do we even use something other than delimited data for this? Delimited data is very good if you are returning back homogeneous data. All right. What do I mean by that? I mean data where every row looks the same. Every row looks the same in our dictionary example. All right? We have a word, a semicolon, a number, a colon, then we repeat that for as many words as we have. All right? So every piece of data looks the same. But let's imagine a more difficult search. All right? Let's imagine where we were doing a search where we were returning information about books in a library, where we could search maybe by subject, we could search by author, we could search by title, we could search by all different kinds of things. All right? If I were to type in a author, if I type in an author name, let's say, I type in Smith, right? There might be a bunch of Smiths in the library database. So I might display a list of names of the authors Smith, right? For each author, there might be a list of books that they've written, all right? I might have more additional copies of books. For example, I might have a hardcover and a paperback version of a book, all right? I might have video recordings that they did. So if I typed in Charles Dickens, I might have, let's imagine what I might have. I might have a hardcover copy of Tale of Two Cities, a paperback copy of Tale of Two Cities, a graphic novel version of Tale of Two Cities. I might have a video recording of Great Expectations, a biography of Charles Dickens, and so on. In other words, I might get back a lot of different kinds of information if I did a simple search on an author. I might get biographical information. I might get information about books. I might get information about editions of books. I might get information about video recordings or books on tape by that author. So I could get back a lot of different kinds of information. That is very difficult to represent using delimited data. Because what you have to do when you have delimited data is you have to give a record type associated with each record. So maybe if I did a search on Dickens, and again, we're just thinking of the famous Dickens, right? Charles Dickens. There could be like Bill Dickens, who was also a poet, all right, in Illinois, or something like that, that might have some books. So, if I did a search on Dickens, I might get back something like this, if I was using delimited data. This a bunch of different ways. I'll do it the way I probably would do it in this hypothetical case. Maybe he was born in 1801. I don't know when he was born, but we'll make that up. And died in 1872. might look like this. And this is what I mean by heterogeneous data. In other words, the data is different. Each row is not the same. The first row in this hypothetical example is author information. The second row is information about hardcover books. And again, there might be a whole bunch of twos, right? There wouldn't just be the one, but I got lazy. But there might be 15 twos of all the hardcover books by Charles Dickens in the library. Three indicates paperback, so there might be a half dozen paperback books. Four might be video recordings, and again, I have a couple of video recordings. And then we start with the next author whose name matched. In other words, we start with the next person named Dickens. And there might be a whole bunch of Dickens that were authors. Now, what's tough about this with delimited data? What's tough about this is our code has to recognize that these rows all go together. And our code has to figure out that it has to know that one means author information, two means hardcover, three means paperback, and so on. So our algorithm has to keep these things grouped together to understand that a Christmas story, the author associated with it is Charles Dickens. All right? And our code has to do that. And we don't really have any help doing that. We have to manage the matching up of all those data. And then when we get to this person, we know, okay, we've now started a different person. All right? So any books that are after this person belong to that person, and so on. What does this number represent? It represents, like, we might assign an author a number, and that's how we group all their pieces of work together. The idea, though, is that we have to manage that ourselves with our code. All right? Now, in the case of XML, we use tags, and the tags help us manage that grouping and matching up this heterogeneous data together. So, what would the XML for this look like? The XML might look like this. I might have a search tag indicating that this is search results. I might have an author tag with a name, with a first name tag, Charles, and a last name, Dickens. Then I might have hardcover books. One thing you should notice about this, right? It's taken me a long time to write this down compared to how long it took me to write that down. That's actually relevant. for Charles Dickens. All right. Notice again, we're returning back different pieces of data like we're returning here, but we indicate what those pieces of data are via tags. This makes our job parsing the data very easy. In other words, if I simply wanted to display the different authors, my code would have to be smart enough to know that one means author, so skip any rows that aren't one. All right? Whereas in XML data, I could simply say, give me all the author tags. For each author tag, give me the first name tag and the last name tag. All right? How do I know what hardcover books belong to Charles Dickens? Well, I find the tag associated with Charles Dickens, and I grab all the hardcover tags that are associated with that tag. And the good news is there's objects that help us to do that. So we don't have to write code that looks at each character and looks for greater than signs and slashes and all that. All right? We can simply say, give me every author tag. For the first author tag, give me the first name. Give me the second name. Give me all the hardcover books associated. Give me all the hardcover tags associated with that author. For each hardcover tag, give me the title. All right? And so on. We can write fairly simple, straightforward commands that do that. All right, and that do that for all the data in the XML data. So we don't have to write the logic that's smart enough to match up these things together, because the tags already tell us that. And just like HTML tags can have the values of the tags and can have attributes, we can have attributes on our XML tags if we want. So for example, if there was an author ID, we could put that as an attribute of the author tag if we needed that for whatever reason. So the difference between these two, if I could summarize, is this is unstructured data. This, we get back a blob of data and our program has to sort it out and understand what goes with what. This is structured data. It comes back as a series of tags and is built into the data what belongs with what. And there's objects that allow us to pull out the stuff that belongs together. We just have to know how to use those objects and make the call to that. So if I was going to summarize when to use XML versus delimited data, all right, XML is most useful when the data is more complicated, when you're not returning back homogeneous data but heterogeneous data. That is, data where each piece of data means something a little bit different. In this case, we have data about people, hardcover books, paperback books, and video recordings. All right? That's better represented with XML data. Now, with every advantage comes a disadvantage. What do you suppose the disadvantage of XML is? And I'll give you a hint. It has to do with the fact that it took me a lot longer to write that than to write that. All right, let's talk about the concept of overhead with data. All right, what do you think I mean with overhead when I talk about overhead? Yes?
Like extra computing or resources that are needed.
Yeah, and extra computing resources. And specifically in this case, I'm talking about the extra data that we have to make this work. So, what is our, quote, overhead with delimited data? Well, if we follow the same strategy, like if we used commas and semicolons to separate this data, What's the extra data?
This, I suppose, counts as extra data. This is a number, so maybe that counts as extra data or not. All right, I'll say this is, this isn't. But the commas are extra data. That's not really data.
That's what we're using to separate the pieces of data. So the comma isn't something that we're going to output to the user. The comma is something that we need to get our job done.
So the commas are overhead. The record type is overhead. So if we were going to look at this, we would have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27. We would have 27 bytes of data. And how many bytes of overhead? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 bytes of overhead. So out of 34 bytes total, 7 of it is overhead. That would be roughly 20%.
All right. And actually, with the delimited data, that number probably would be smaller. All right. For real delimited data. This example, the overhead seems a little high. Let's count up how much overhead we have for the author in XML. And let's just do the same amount, the author's name. Well, I could count, but if I did this right, I would find out I have the same 27 bytes of data. Right? Because I'm sending the same piece of data over.
Let's count how much overhead we have, though. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 41.
I'm not going to count them all, but we're already, I'm not even all the way through, and we have 41 bytes of overhead. All right?
So, to extrapolate a little bit, it probably would not be ridiculous to say that when I was finished counting, we would have, say, 70 bytes of data. I just made up that number, but the convenient thing is that does... That makes my math easy, because that almost adds up to 100 bytes of data. Let's say we had 73 bytes of data. That will really make my math easy for me.
All right?
That means for 100 bytes that we're sending, only 27 of them are real data. So therefore,
overhead. All right. So we're sending a lot of extra data to get that extra benefit, which, I mean, logically makes sense, right? We're sending better data. We're sending more complete, more structured data over. Of course it makes sense that we're going to have to send more characters over to accomplish that, right? We're sending more stuff over. We're sending more data over. Because we're sending information about the relationships between data, so we're going to send more characters over. So that can be a problem. We actually did some studies for a project I worked on ages ago. And it is actually that delimited data took up about 1/10 the data in our particular situation as compared to XML. So what does that mean? Well, that means that you're sending 10 times the data for every time you're sending some data between the client and the server. Now, does that prove to be problematic? Well, it depends on the problem, and it depends on the data.
So if a viewer is sending back simple data, homogeneous data, then the limited data is probably the way to go. If you're sending back complicated data, where there are a lot of different data types and there's relationships between the pieces of data, then the benefit that you gain by sending that is probably better to send that rather than sending the limited data. So it's a trade-off. Overhead versus more complete data. All right.
So you can get element by tag name, and you can pull the value of a tag out of that. Now, these only work if you give legal XML. And what is legal XML? Well, the rules are similar to the rules of legal HTML, but they're a little stricter. So, for example, in HTML, it's possible to have some tags that don't have an ending tag. In XML, every tag has an ending tag. All right? XML, all the tag names are lowercase, I believe, as are attribute names. There's a few other restrictions, but pretty much it's the same. The main difference is that every tag is going to have a ending tag. All right, so let's look at our XML example. And we'll talk about what's going to be the difference and what's going to be different and what's going to be the same between the delimited example that we saw last week and the XML example that we see this week. The one thing that we haven't talked about today, and we'll talk about it in a subsequent class, is JSON data. JSON is a different way of representing data, and you can almost think of it as being between delimited data and XML. You know, if I was trying to think of an analogy, but I don't know. None of the analogies rolling around in my head are good. But if delimited data is a screwdriver, and XML might be the Swiss Army knife, all right? It has a screwdriver, but it has 50 other things in there as well. JSON data might be a screwdriver that you can swap the tip on. So you can get a Phillips screwdriver or a regular screwdriver. Maybe a big Phillips screwdriver, a little Phillips screwdriver, and a big and little regular screwdriver. I guess what I'm saying is that delimited data is less versatile, more simple. XML is the most versatile and the most complex. And that's not a coincidence, by the way. The versatility comes at a price. All right, and that price is complexity. And then finally, JSON fits somewhere in between. Not as simple as delimited, not as versatile as XML. On the other hand, it's more versatile than delimited, and it's less overhead than XML. So it fits in that niche, sort of right smack dab in the middle. All right, so let's pull down the example that we had. And let's look at what we had last week, and then we will look at the XML version of it. Before we do that, though, I want to sort of play a thought experiment. Let's look at the delimited version, and let's see if we can predict what code is going to change and what code is going to stay the same. Again, we're comparing the delimited version with the XML version. Now, I've already said that the second Ajax request stays the same. So this guy, dictionary 2, is going to stay exactly the same. And everything in my dictionary HTML that relates to that second request, get translation and display translation, that's going to stay the same. I already know that. Of course, you can't see any of this. But the only thing that we're going to talk about here is the first second request, everything about the second request is going to stay the same. All right? And why is it staying the same? Because this is even simpler than delimited data. We're simply getting one value back. That is the translated word. So we're not even getting back enough to justify delimited data. Remember, the whole reason for even having this discussion is because we want our server to return back multiple stuff. All right? And when the server returns back multiple stuff, there needs to be a way for the client to differentiate and to parse and to break down that multiple stuff into its components. So again, the second request where we're simply returning the Spanish term, there's no need to even parse that. And likewise, over here, where we make the request and display the translation, nothing's going to be changed there because, again, we're simply getting back one value from our server-side code. No need to break it down. Is this code going to stay the same or different between our XML and delimited version? That's going to stay the same. Why is that? What does this code do?
That's just setting up the request object.
So we're going to make the request the same way. We're using the same object to make the request to the server. All right? So that's not going to change. Is making the request going to change? We have a vote for yes. Any other votes? Actually, this isn't going to change, right? We're making a request the same way. We're going to ask the server to give us a list of words that start with A or AB or ABC or whatever, right? That's the same whether we're getting it back as delimited data or whether we're getting it back as XML data. So the request is the same. All right. The server-side code that produces the output, is that going to be the same? Well, no, all right, because it's going to be outputting XML. It's not going to be outputting delimited data. So you can see in this case, we're delimiting, we're outputting stuff separated by semicolons, and then stuff separated by semicolons and colons. We're not outputting any XML tags at all. All right, so yeah, that's going to have to change. And finally, the code that parses the results and, in this case, produces a dropdown, is that going to change? Yes, it's going to change because it's now getting the data back as XML and not delimited data. All right, so it's going to have to parse XML as opposed to parsing delimited data. So really, two pieces of this are going to change to convert this. We make the request in the same way. We create the request object the same way. What changes is the PHP code is going to respond with a different kind of data, and then the client-side code is going to have to deal with that different format of data. So that's the two pieces of this that are going to change. Now, I will say, if I was doing this example for real, I would not use XML. But I wanted to show you the same example done in all three formats. XML really works best when you have different data and not just a homogeneous block of data. All right. I'm going to copy over the XML version
just to verify to you that it works the same way. So now if I go to my web browser and type in localhost, dictionary.html, from the user's perspective, it should be no different. All right. What I want to end today with is showing you what I'm getting back from the server. I'm getting back XML. My root node, that's one thing I didn't mention, but every XML document has a single root node, like one tag that everything is contained in. It's called the root node. In HTML, that would be the HTML tag. In this case, I have the word list tag. And my word list consists of a series of items. Each item has a word and an index associated with it. Now again, without going and counting the number of characters, you can see that this is a much more data we're getting back, because again, the overhead is much bigger with XML via delimited data. So that's what we get back. All right? I'm going to spend a second looking at the server-side code, and then we'll pick up on that next time. We'll notice a couple things right off the bat. First of all, we output the data differently. I put content, I create a header that says I am outputting XML. Now, what is the importance of that? The importance of that is now the data is going to go back to the client in a different way. It is not going to go back into the variable called response text. It is going to go back to the variable response XML. So that's one difference that you'll notice when we continue looking at this on Wednesday, is that the data does not go back to response text. The data goes back to response XML. Now, the rest of the logic is very similar. The only difference being is, instead of separating things by commas and semicolons, we wrap things up in HTML tags, not HTML, but XML tags, and output that back to the user via an echo. Just like we did before, except we're outputting a bunch of tags. The shell of this looks the same, but instead of outputting semicolons and colons as a separator, we output the tags as a separator. Okay. Next time we'll take a look at this again to make sure that we understand how the XML is being created, and then we will look at the code that parses the XML. All right? And again, we're not left on our own for that. One of the benefits of using XML is you get an object that helps you to parse XML. XML is a standard format for data exchange. Therefore, someone has already written and incorporated into the DOM the logic to handle XML data in an XML object.
So we will go and see how we can use that to parse it. All right, that's all I had for today. Any questions? All right, we'll see you over in lab.